Well, good afternoon, and welcome to this next panel. Tom Frieden, who's our third panelist, is coming, but he's running late, so we're going to go ahead and get started. I'm Rich Besser. I'm with ABC News. It still feels funny to say that, but it's. I think you're in for a very interesting hour. On the panel, I'm not going to go through long bios, so that it won't take. Time from our questions, but I have Nicole Lurie, who's the Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response in Health and Human Services, and Andy Weber, who's the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Nuclear, Chemical, Biological Defense Programs in DOD. Couldn't ask for a better panel to be looking at where we are now. Now, unlike the last panel, where the speakers were not in government, our full panel today is in government. And will be able to give us a perspective of where our programs are now and where they see things moving forward. I'm going to have some easy questions and some not so easy questions. And I'll start with a somewhat easy question. It's a question I never liked when I was at CDC, but it's not that hard. It's the what keeps you up at night question. And the reason I never liked that is that I'm a really good sleeper, and so while there were things that I worried about, I always slept, and so I felt I was a little dishonest when I would say what kept me up at night, when in fact I was sleeping very well. So, Nikki, I'll start with you. When it comes to biosecurity issues, what are those things that you're worried about most?
Well, I will say, too, that I'm a pretty good sleeper. And so it takes a lot to keep me up at night. But I would say there are two things really at the top of my agenda. One is just something that we've never anticipated before and don't have a way to mitigate against. Hey, Tom. By and large, I suspect that would be something either caused by Mother Nature or by some combination of events, you know, like what we saw in Fukushima, that we just hadn't anticipated and wasn't within the wildest scope of our imagination. So that's one piece of what keeps me up at night, and that's why we have really started to focus on developing the capability to make countermeasures against something we've never seen before. It's really out of that concern that, in some sense, we may never be as nimble as Mother Nature, but we have to be as nimble as we can be in this. The other thing that keeps me up a lot is that we'll find out about it too late to do anything about it.
So that detection issue.
The detection issue. And that really speaks to detection, surveillance, and frankly, to some extent, communication.
Right. And in this, I'd love to promote a conversation. So if anyone wants to chime in on anyone else's answer, feel free. Tom, welcome. It's great to see you. This is the what keeps you up at night question. Andy, what are those things that worry you the most?
Well, I pay a lot of attention to what our adversaries are saying. And it keeps me up at night when I read in the Al Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, Inspire magazine. Although the main author of that has now been killed in a successful counterterrorist operation recently, when he put out a call to microbiologists and chemists to develop weapons of mass destruction, that keeps me up at night. Knowing what we know about the potential accessibility of select agents, especially in other parts of the world, at veterinary laboratories and public health laboratories that traditionally have not even considered security as something to focus on. What keeps me up at night is the potential of a day after, and this is something that we in government think a lot about. What is it the day after an attack? What is it that we could have been doing either faster or more effectively, or for a failure of imagination hadn't been doing, that could have prevented such an attack and prepared us better for such an attack? So that's why it's so important to have the commitment and the brain power that UPMC and the Sloan Foundation have gathered in this room, because these are hard problems. They're enduring problems. Over time, they're not necessarily getting better. So we just have to work work at it and keep at it.
Tom?
Well, like you, Rich, I sleep very well at night, so I can't honestly answer this question, but I will say the things that worry me most are that we're almost certainly not going to face the thing that we're preparing for. Therefore, what's most important is that we increase our general ability to detect and respond. And if you think of the four fundamental things we do signal detection, laboratory diagnosis, epidemiologic investigation, and control measures. We are falling behind in two critical ways. First is the troops on the ground. There are 44,000 fewer people working at state and local health departments today than there were 2 years ago. That's fewer people to detect and respond to problems as they occur and limit the damage. I think we can take a lot of the health threats that we face day in and day out as drills, free drills, if you will, for preparedness. Colorado has a strong health department funded in part by CDC to investigate foodborne illness. On September 2nd, Friday, before any laboratory testing came back that did DNA matching, they realized that they had a higher than expected number of cases of listeria. They worked through the Labor Day weekend interviewing patients, and within days they had identified cantaloupe as the source, and within days after that had it off the shelves, recalled, and a public warning. Colorado is one of only 10 states that we provide that kind of support to. If it had happened somewhere else, we could have had a much broader outbreak than actually did exist. So we're falling behind in our preparedness at the state and local level. We're also falling behind in the high-tech areas of detection and response. We have tremendous new capabilities or potential capabilities with molecular detection, with bioinformatics, with the generation of huge amounts of information that we're not well equipped as a country, at CDC, frankly, at state and local health departments, to rapidly use and react to. So I think what worries me most is that our capacities to detect and respond are being eroded on the one hand and are not growing where they need to grow on the other.
You know, Andy, you mentioned the threats that you see in the Inspire for WMD. What does DOD need to do in the years ahead to prepare for those kinds of threats?
Well, clearly it's a whole of government approach that's required, not just here in the United States, but globally. And I will say, with strong leadership from the White House, the teamwork that we've developed along with other counterparts like Tara O'Toole and Homeland Security is like nothing I've experienced in 26 years of federal service. And we have strong leadership, and we work together on a regular basis. We've become friends in the process, and the nature of the biological threat requires a whole of government response. And not only here, but for example, we had a bioterrorism tabletop exercise in the Republic of Korea together with U.S. Forces Korea. And on our side of the table, we had senior leadership from the centers, U.S. Centers for Disease Control, from the Department of Health and Human Services, Homeland Security, including FEMA and Health Affairs. And that really enabled the Republic of Korea to bring together partners that maybe hadn't worked together. We had, sadly, we had the luxury of an attack in this country 10 years ago that accelerated the process of interagency partnership on the biological threat space. And other countries around the world are probably about 10 years behind us. And I think we've made great progress in narrowing the cultural divide between public health and security. But that's something we have to continue to work at and show leadership on a global basis.
Tom, when I was still in government, one of the things that was said to me during the period of transition was that CDC's priorities were out of whack. that we were focusing far too much on low probability, high consequence events, and not enough on the health problems affecting people today: diabetes, obesity, cancer. What are your thoughts on that? Can public health do both? And how do you do that in the current environment?
I think we need a balanced portfolio. We need to address the problems of today. We need to address security. If we don't address communicable diseases and threats of bioterrorism or other natural disasters, we're not doing our core work. But if we don't also address stroke and heart attack and cancer, we're abdicating our responsibility to promote health. So I don't see a conflict between those two broad areas. Now, there are more and less overlaps between them, but fundamentally, if you have a strong public health system with strong capacity to identify problems, to use data to improve decisions, and with a strong connection with the clinical system, you can both detect and respond to communicable and other external threats, and have a better outcomes in our cancer screening and cardiovascular prevention programs. So I think there is some tension there, to be frank, but the funding for preparedness has been a lifeline for public health and has allowed us to increase our ability to communicate with healthcare workers and to bridge the gap between clinical medicine and public health. It's allowed us to improve communication, data management, epidemiologic skills, and all of that is multivalent, if you will. It has the ability to respond to a Fukushima, it has the ability to respond to listeria, and it has the ability to drive down heart attacks and strokes.
Nikki, we're 10 years after the anthrax attack. Billions of dollars have been invested in bioterrorism preparedness and response. Law enforcement still alerts us to the threat of bioterrorism. We see it in things like Inspire. But during this decade, there's not been an attack. We're in a period where government is slashing budgets left and right. Is it time to reassess our investment in bioterrorism and pull back?
Well, I think like Tom and like Andy, I think we all appreciate both the budget constraints we're under. We all appreciate the fact that we need a balanced portfolio, and we need to take a really long, hard look at what we're doing. One of the things that I think is hard for us, as we say, as Andy did, yes, we've been successful in the counterterrorism, some of the counterterrorism efforts, we're making headway there. So maybe we're sort of delaying some, maybe not, we just don't know, what might happen in terms of the inevitable. At the same time, it's not that I'm so worried in the particularly in the medical countermeasure sphere and preparedness about what might happen tomorrow or next year. But with this march of science that we've just been talking about and with the length of time it takes to develop countermeasures, I'm worried about what's going to happen between now and 10 years from now or 15 years from now. And the decisions that we make now on our watch are going to determine how ready we are to respond to something 10 or 15 years from now. So I think we have to keep that time horizon in mind. It's a tough thing to do, I think, when we have the budget slashing efforts that we have. So no, I don't think we can take our foot off the gas here. I think we can be deliberate, we can be disciplined. We've put in place over the past year and a half or two a decision-making process, a governance process, all of those sorts of things for how it is that we make these investments, how we prioritize those investments going forward. And we're looking much more toward the kinds of capabilities that we need, A, in the event of the unknown, and B, kind of products that will help with the day-to-day use in the event of an attack, whether it's a next-generation ventilator, whether it's new broad-spectrum antimicrobials for emerging infectious diseases, or synthetic biology. And as Tom talks about all the time, as do the rest of us, you know, one of the things that was really clear through H1N1 is that it's the day-to-day capabilities that you have in place that are the ones you're going to count on in a pandemic. I always say if you can't do it day-to-day, you can't do it on game day. So continuing to invest in those core day-to-day capabilities, whether they're in public health, whether they're in countermeasure development, whether they're in communications, all of those areas are really critical. And no, I don't think it's time to take our foot off the gas there at all.
Given that we're not likely to face what we're preparing for, and that science is moving forward very quickly, the ability to develop new threats is kind of beyond our comprehension. You have both talked about the importance of being able to develop countermeasures very quickly, and DoD and HHS, you know, have plans moving forward for development of manufacturing facilities to get this going. When will that capability be a reality? Are the two efforts in sync? Is pharma working with you all in doing this? So that were we to face a situation like a contagion, where they were able to produce a vaccine incredibly fast. It was miraculously fast, actually. And a vaccine that works instantly, which was also incredible. Sorry, I hope I didn't ruin the movie for anybody. But so where are we in terms of our ability to make a countermeasure quickly?
Let me distinguish between a couple of efforts here, because you sort of smushed together a very technical term.
We do that in journalism.
a number of the things that we're working on. First of all, we need the scientific and technological capability to be able to develop a countermeasure against something quickly that we have never seen before. This is a scientific challenge. It's a technological challenge. It's not something that building a manufacturing facility right now is going to take care of on its own. But we've been looking very hard at the kinds of platform technologies and multi-use technologies that are out there to get us there. That's going to take a while. But we're moving in that direction, and I think that's incredibly important. At the same time, the Centers for Advanced Development and Manufacturing, which we hope to be able to award next year, will do a couple of things. One is that they're going to help our current and future developers overcome scientific, technical, regulatory, other challenges they can't do on their own because they might not have the know-how or the resources, and can't necessarily, because they're usually small, buy their way out of. That's part one. And then secondly, when those technologies are there and are ripe, we'll use those facilities in the event of a surge to be able to, or in a need to be able to surge quickly once the technologies are developed. But those are two separate things, both of whom, which are necessary to be able to move us forward. With regard to flu, because of contagion, I want to say we have made, even in the past 2 years, enormous progress. We've been reading about the hopes for universal flu vaccine, and I will stress encouraging, but hopes for. At the same time, we are supporting the development of recombinant flu vaccines, which we haven't had before. We have a cell-based facility in Holly Springs that is now, if it needed to, able to surge manufacture vaccine much faster. We've been working hard on things like reducing the time through potency testing and sterility testing. Now have a new sterility test that is being used that takes time off of the development of vaccine. We're not yet at contagion speed, nor have we figured out how to make the immune system work as fast as you pointed out. But we're getting there, and I want to say, in that space, there's been really huge progress. I can see light at the end of that tunnel.
Andy?
Well, in part because of our experience responding to H1N1, and the fact that it took 8 months to deliver a vaccine to the public, President Obama launched a medical countermeasures initiative, and HHS and DOD are attached at the hip on implementation of this, but it's about developing a national capability for rapid, flexible response from detection, characterization, all the way through the ability to manufacture a safe and deliver a safe medical countermeasure. We're working very closely with FDA in this endeavor. The Department of Defense about 2 weeks ago issued an RFP for the Advanced Development and Manufacturing Center of Excellence that we intend to fund, and we hope certainly that even in this difficult fiscal environment that the congressional appropriators support that, so we can move quickly forward in developing these really vital capabilities.
You know, there's one thing, Rich, since you want to spark a little conversation, that's outside of this technological scientific space that I want to talk about. It's something we've been working very hard on, and Andy's comment reminded me of it. During H1N1, not only did it take a long time for us to get vaccine made and then get it delivered to people and all those sort of things, it took us a really long time to move money from a congressional appropriation through the federal government, to state government, to local government, to people on the ground that had to do the work. That's not a scientific challenge, but it is a bureaucratic and administrative challenge. One of the things that we've been doing, again, in concert with our colleagues at CDC, at the White House, et cetera, is putting in place a system that we're sort of glibly calling budget preparedness, so that, in fact, we don't have these long delays in budgets and decision-making going forward, and that we can actually get to the point where the people on the ground can be mobilized to do their work much more quickly.
So if there were a pandemic starting today, you'd be able to get money faster to people at the state and local level?
Well, what we want to have in place is a system of decision-making so that we can decide in advance and have an agreement on advance what are things we need to spend money on. We cannot have lots and lots of conversations or as many conversations about how to do it. We don't necessarily have to go through a complex granting mechanism or contracting mechanism with the states to be able to get money to the states. Similarly, states might not, once this is all fully operational, have to have contracts themselves out on the street for long periods of time. Every single place you look in that process, there were due loops and delays that slowed us down in aggregate a huge amount. We're not going to be able to turn it on overnight, but I think we're making a huge amount of progress. The CDC FEP and FER grants have made huge progress in that regard, so that we now have a mechanism to get money to states quickly, and we're working.
Tom, you want to jump in on this one?
Well, I just would go at the other end of the system as well in the detection. H1N1 was probably spreading in Mexico for a couple of months before it was recognized. If we had had 2 months more to make vaccine, even with our cumbersome vaccine process, it would have been a very different picture in terms of when vaccine became available and what the uptake was. And that really emphasizes that we are all connected by the air we breathe, by the water we drink, by the food we eat, and we have a need to strengthen surveillance globally, because if there's a lack of detection anywhere, all of us are at higher risk. So we're delighted in the partnerships that we have with DOD on programs like the Global Disease Detection Program, programs to train epidemiologists around the world to detect and respond to problems. And we need to do more to strengthen public health institutions around the world, public health laboratories around the world, so that they are in place to rapidly detect and call the alarm. We're fortunate that at CDC, we're able to partner on an agency-to-agency basis. As part of Health and Human Services, our counterpart is the Ministry of Health. We've worked with, for example, the government of China, which has created the China CDC. CDC doesn't actually mean anything in Chinese, but it says in big letters, China CDC. And they have become, with our support, a global collaborating center on influenza. What does that mean? That means every week they post on the internet the genetic sequences of the flu strains that they identified. All of the world benefits from that, as well as China. And that kind of strengthening and partnership is crucially important to continue to build on, because we're not going to build a moat around this country. We're all connected. And if we think that we can protect ourselves and let there be huge black holes of awareness in much of the world, we're deluding ourselves.
You know, Tom, you and Nikki have both addressed some lessons you've learned coming out of H1N1. And I think that there's a feeling within public health that the response to H1N1 was a success. But that's not what I hear in many of the circles in which I'm living right now. There's a sense of overreaction, government crying wolf. What's your thought on that? How do you avoid the situation of crying wolf and gaining the trust of the public so that they take the measures to heart that you think are important?
I think, Rich, as you did at the time and as all of us strive to do, it's key to be very clear about what we know, to be very clear about what we don't know, and then to be honest about how we're trying to find out more. When H1N1 burst onto the scene, it was with very high case fatality from Mexico City. And in the kind of fog of war of the ensuing days and weeks, it was a while before we'd say, you know, this doesn't look like it's worse than seasonal flu. It may be more explosively spreading. We had outbreaks in schools with 1,000 kids sick in the course of days. So it took us a while to identify the epidemiology, but quite quickly, CDC and ACIP came up with recommendations, which, though some quibble with, essentially stood the test of time in terms of who should be priority for vaccination. We'll always rather over-prepare, but one key lesson is that it's always better to under-promise and over-deliver than the reverse. And I think if we had it to do over again, if we did not make any predictions as to when vaccine would be available and in what quantities, or had the most conservative possible assumptions of that, you'd actually have a very different retrospective perspective on how things went. Plus, I think it is important to recognize H1N1 made 60 million Americans sick. It caused more than 100,000 hospitalizations. It killed more than 10,000 people, including more than 1,000 kids, many times more kids than die in a normal flu season. This was not a mild flu season. It was a flu season that was different from other flu seasons and hit young people harder. But I think getting some of those facts out is very important. And the bottom line is always to be frank about what do we know, what do we don't know, what does it show?
Andy, what are your big lessons coming out of H1N1?
Well, I think it's important that we draw the right lessons. And I don't think crying wolf or hyping the problem is the right lesson. Whether it was Bruce Ivan's attacks with anthrax 10 years ago, I mean, the key lesson from that experience to me is not that five people died, therefore anthrax isn't a big deal. It's that one person launched those attacks from growing the bacteria to through weaponization and delivery. He certainly did some of the potential victims a favor by writing a letter saying you've been exposed to anthrax, so we put thousands of people on Cipro and were able to save a lot of lives. But that's the key lesson to me, is that the potential for a lone wolf bioterrorist or a small group mounting such an attack is not just a hypothetical. And in terms of H1N1, I agree entirely with Tom that the lesson is that it spread around the world like wildfire. Not that it was a fairly mild form of the disease, but that nobody has a moat around them anymore in this world. I was in Australia, and their moat is better than our moat, but it's still not good enough. And we need to do what Josh Lederberg told us in the 1992 Institute of Medicine Support had to be done, and he, the visionary that he was, understood where technologies were going. We need to have a real-time global system for early warning of outbreaks that actually allows us to contain an outbreak in Mexico, to prevent epidemics from occurring and from spreading. And the technologies are here and now today. It's a matter of, and we're working very closely together on this, pulling them together. There's fragmentation, whether it be in the electronic reporting systems or point-of-care diagnostics. If we can bring some sense to this through leadership, through some of our government funding capabilities, we can have a huge impact in implementing, finally, Josh's vision of a real-time global surveillance network where countries are in this together, they share data real-time, just like we do today with weather data.
So I would agree very much, you know, with the comments of Tom and Andy, and I would add one other piece of this that we haven't talked about so much, and that is maintaining and frankly improving the confidence of the public. All of our principles of risk communication are terribly important. You were the first person that really sort of epitomized those on the national and and global stage through H1N1. But we still had an awful lot of people who didn't want to get vaccinated at the end of the day. And were this a more severe disease, were it a different kind of attack, I don't want to be in a situation where half of the public won't accept a medical countermeasure and will either die or infect other people in the process. I think we still have a huge amount of work to do in this area of understanding the public concerns and doing something kind of game-changing about it. The new communications technologies we have are a double-edged sword. They can help or they can get in the way. You know, my colleague Bruce Gellin had a wonderful phrase that I quote all the time, which says, you know, a lot of times we do the same thing, only louder. Louder just isn't good enough here. I think we need to think about some really game-changing ways to engage the public, engage, and frankly, earn the public's trust in this arena. And with a countermeasure, with distributing something against something we've never seen before, it's going to be hard. And this is another place where we have to be working now and not let our foot off the gas.
I mean, one thing I've learned recently from CDC is that if you're ready for a zombie attack, you're ready for anything. But I thought that was an incredibly clever way to get people thinking about emergency preparedness who zone it out whenever they hear that.
Breaking through the cacophony of voices and the complexity of the modern media and communications environment isn't easy. But for $87 for the rights to one photograph, we generated millions and millions of dollars of awareness and taught lots of people how much water they needed and the kind of things that they could do, and got a lot of school kids talking about CDC and zombies, which was a surprise.
Yeah. I'm going to ask a couple more questions, and then I want questions from the floor. When we get to questions from the floor, please identify yourself and your affiliation and ask a question, no speeches. So the speeches are for the break time, which we are going to get to. So I want to ask a question about international response to either a bioterrorist event or a large national international disaster. I was in Haiti right after the earthquake, and I saw the arrival of the American health response. Teams ready to provide care. HHS in charge of those teams that were providing care. CDC epidemiologists there to do surveillance, security being provided by DOD, and Department of State in charge. And so three parts of government that were to be working efficiently on the ground. And I have to tell you, it was not a pretty picture. It was contrasted to me looking at the Israeli response, where it was an integrated unit that had, you know, security, everything there that was ready to go. Is international response to a health event one of the things that you see as a mission for the U.S. government? And if so, what's being done to make sure that it continues to improve? And I don't know who wants to jump in on that first.
Well, I think it's clearly vitally important. At CDC, we respond dozens of times a year, either in person or by remote assistance to health events, whether it's Ebola in Uganda or the spread of drug-resistant organisms elsewhere. And it is a complex response because the U.S. government's approach necessarily builds on the strengths of different parts of government. And within country, State Department has a crucial role in the rationalization and coordination function. And if we take a different kind of emergency response, I think there are some real lessons to be learned from PEPFAR, the President's Emergency Program for AIDS Relief. PEPFAR said, look, this is a big problem, it's a tough problem, we need everyone involved, the ambassador's in charge, the State Department will serve as the honest broker and decide who does what best and get it done. And as a result of that kind of results-focused approach, 3.2 million people are alive today on medications who would be dead or dying otherwise. 110,000 babies were born without HIV last year who would have been HIV infected otherwise. And we were able to then take the best of different parts of government and make them work together in one way. And that's a different kind of emergency response, but I think it's a very important model of emergency response because there are comparative advantages, and sometimes the job is so big that you need everyone putting their shoulder to the wheel.
Nikki?
Yeah, I want to go back actually not to the Haiti experience, but again, some of the components of H1N1. And, you know, I've said a lot of times that I don't think there's a single person in the country or the world that really understood all of the steps involved. So even after we had vaccine was here and we wanted to be able to share it, donate it, do whatever, with countries around the world, there were numerous barriers that were regulatory, that were legal, that whatever. All the planning in the world hadn't really gotten us to the point where we had a set of documents that you could sign and transport vaccine. I think my favorite was the fumigation certificate for the wood pallet that they went on. But we still, whether we want, if we were going to receive goods and services in this country or we're going to donate or send goods and services to another country, particularly in terms of products, there is a lot of work to do to be able to do that kind of international response in addition to the kinds of international response that Tom talked about. So whether it was there, whether it was around Fukushima.
But is rapid response to an international disaster a mission for the government? And if so, you know, what are we doing to make sure that it can be done quickly?
USAID has the OFDA, the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance, and they take the lead in coordinating to clear large humanitarian emergencies like the Haiti earthquake. There are other emergency responses that don't fall under that rubric, an Ebola outbreak, right, for example.
Well, and those are things CDC has traditionally done exceedingly well. It's these big, mega ones that, you know, I don't know. Is it part of the mission? And if so, you know, Andy, what do you think?
Yes, it is. And there are a couple of things that we've been doing that we need to keep expanding. And one is to focus on enhancing capacity around the world because, you know, we're only as strong as the weakest link. And these are all global issues. So through technical assistance programs that strengthen international health regulation capacity around the world, we can have an impact on preparedness and response capabilities. One thing we do in DOD routinely, and I think we both domestically and internationally, is planning and exercising, you know, tabletop exercises, field exercises. And then use those, identify capability gaps, and then work the gaps and have a continual process. And that is something that we need to do, you know, not just as Richard suggested in New York and Detroit, but we need to do it work it just as hard in Southeast Asia and other parts of the world, because these are by definition global problems and they require global efforts. President Obama, when he spoke to the UN General Assembly just a couple of weeks ago, I just want to quote what he said. He said, "To stop disease that spreads across borders, we must strengthen our system of public health. And we must come together to prevent and detect and fight every kind of biological danger, whether it's a pandemic like H1N1, or a terrorist threat, or a treatable disease." And it's that type of global leadership and really a global effort that can have an impact on improving our preparedness and global response capabilities.
But let me go back to some of the rest of your question, Rich, because it's not like nothing's been going on. There's now an international response division developing an international CONOPS, working with DOD, USAID, others, and both that defines more clearly the processes, but also is going to have to define what are the triggers for when we need to go and help and when we don't. You know, when the Fukushima events, the Japan events unfolded before the nuclear power plant, folks were pre-positioned on the West Coast, ready to go and help if needed, and I'll stress if needed, by the time we all woke up here in the morning, ready to go in a pretty coordinated way. Japan is a very capable government. They've got a very capable emergency response system. Didn't need that kind of help. But I think it's an exemplar of how we've been changing some of the way we do things and that kind of government coordination. So there has been a lot of attention to that. Obviously, Haiti presented a set of really challenging services with so much of the government taken out. But yes, it's something we take seriously. And yes, I think if you looked, you'd see a lot of improvement.
Good. Back to domestic situation. In the last panel, when I was at CDC, the mantra around bioterrorism was, you know, anthrax, anthrax, anthrax. And lots of focus on distribution of countermeasures. And are we able to? And we were listening to DA and Richard talking, the issue of could we quickly, as a country, distribute countermeasures to people to save a population, to save a large city. Where are we now in terms of that capability to either rapidly distribute countermeasures or working on the MedKit project any of those things to get to a population, something that would be needed for anthrax? Or, as you've all been saying, preparing for the known is not going to get us more any safer, because it could be a new germ manufactured in a lab for which our countermeasures are worthless. Tom, do you want to start on that?
We're definitely better prepared now than we ever have been. More states are able to detect rapidly, scramble and organize rapidly, dispense countermeasures. Actually, H1N1 was a great experience for many states and localities. They used football stadiums, schools, drive-throughs, drive-in theaters, and other routes to get large numbers of people vaccinated in a short period of time. I think anthrax and some of the worst possible scenarios in anthrax continue to challenge us in terms of what is a realistic expectation of what we can do, and what can we do that will cause no harm. We know that pre-positioning medications has a lot of appeal, and it might be the right answer for some populations and some communities. We also know from when we've studied that people rapidly forget where they've put it. They take it when they shouldn't. They give it to people who shouldn't have it. It gets expired. It gets put in places that it decays rapidly. So it's been said that for every complicated problem, there's a solution that's quick, simple, and wrong. And I don't think there's a quick and simple solution to some of the big challenges we've got. We are doing more. We are identifying some of the particular vulnerabilities and closing those iteratively. But I really do think that preparedness is about being better prepared today than we were yesterday and better prepared tomorrow than we are today, and not necessarily about buying a huge chunk of any particular item and keeping it in any particular place, although that may have a crucial role, for example, the smallpox vaccine.
I want to say this is a place where we've had tremendous partnership and collaboration with CDC, DOD, DHS, VA, Postal Service, et cetera. And really working together at the direction of the president through his executive order, really looked at the series of things that we need to put in place to do really rapid dispensing. So just a couple weeks ago, for example, there was an exercise out in Los Angeles really looking at what is the federal capability that we'll bring to bear. The state and local governments are the primary responders. The major metropolitan areas have all looked and said, we've got a gap in people to deliver these kind of, and distribute these kind of countermeasures. So we've been looking together with them, with the private sector, with DOD, about how do we close that capability gap in people? How will we real about what it is so that we can deliver countermeasures sooner? We've also been looking at, you know, are there things between a central stockpile and a med kit in everybody's house that could speed up the time? And yes, in fact, for some places it may be that smaller forward prepositioning, some kind of countermeasures, does shave hours off of things. You don't want to have a situation where the countermeasure shows up before the pod is open and people are ready to distribute it, or you'll have chaos. But I think there's been a lot of process engineering looking at this, and a lot of collaborative work across government to say where can federal employees, where can DOD, where can the National Guard, where can other people help here?
I want to open it up to the floor. I don't know if someone's got that microphone to pass around. Any questions from the floor? Up in the front here. If you could say who you are and your affiliation.
Peter Emanuel, Department of Defense. I think you opened up with a really good question in which you were talking about disaster preparedness. I'd like to change that same question, but re-ask it from the perspective of biosurveillance. There was a discussion about PEPFAR and how you had an honest broker that facilitated a very complex situation to find a successful outcome. With the introduction of PPD2, there's been a tremendous amount of push behind interagency efforts for biosurveillance. So we have very complex problems in data fusion and diagnostic and detection devices that need to be globally fielded. What are the feelings of the panel and how we're going to find an honest broker and begin to really tackle these really complex situations to field data fusion networks, diagnostic and detection apparatus that are not just one agency, but actually globally fielded with participation from our allies?
Andy, do you want to start?
Everyone's looking at each other. That's a great question. Yeah. That's a good question.
Well, we're all eager to answer it. I just want to, on your anthrax, yes, it's still anthrax, and the unknowns. It's not an either or. Mm-hmm. It really depends on which adversary you're thinking about. Is it the small terrorist groups with proven intent? In that case, it's anthrax and bot and ricin still. And if we're looking at states with biological weapons programs, it's the unknowns. They know our list. They know our capabilities. It doesn't take a genius to figure out they may use something that's not on our list. So we need to work both of those. We still have a lot to do against the simpler cases, as well as this potential infinite.
So did that answer your question? Next question.
But absolutely, we need to, and we're working this as a team. The leadership here, need to be that honest broker and break down the fragmentation in diagnostics and reporting systems and bring some integration to the effort. And I'm convinced that we will be successful because we must be successful in this.
We're working very closely with DOD on diagnostic platforms and identifying ways that we can build on the work that both of the agencies do. There are some very exciting new technologies out there. Yesterday, I was reviewing something that was actually started at DOD and then further developed by CDC and some of our industrial partners, which can, in minutes, detect up to 21 different respiratory pathogens from 6 different nasopharyngeal specimens in a really broad array. And if we can get that into sentinel surveillance systems and outbreak response systems, we can dramatically improve our awareness of what's happening out there and respond better. But I think the final common pathway here is not going to be a US or even international system of detection and response. It's going to be the hard slog of strengthening country capacity so that countries are able to detect and respond. And then, as per the international health regulation requirements, report them. And one of the interesting things about the IHR is that if one country has a problem and doesn't report it, and another country is aware of that problem, that other country is required to report it. And I will tell you that there have been occasions when we've said, you know, if you don't report this, we're required to. And that has, you know, encouraged people to report. So I do think building the country capacity is crucially important, and we need to do that again, in both the high-tech and the low-tech ways. The high-tech through new diagnostics and the low-tech through trained epidemiologists and linkages to the healthcare system.
Nikki.
And I will make a couple of other comments. First of all, since I've been in this job, one of the things that I'm so stunned with is that we get ourselves crosswise all the time when we use the same words to mean different things. we are still at a place where different people mean different things by the term biosurveillance. Okay, I just want to put that out on the table as still work to do. Number two, as Andy said, I think we as leadership are all really working hard together on this. We have been looking hard at, for example, interagency models of interagency leadership and governance, because there's not going to be probably a single agency solution to all of those problems, and I think that that's really critical. Third piece about this, whether it's in strengthening international surveillance, using all of the amazing information that's out there, either from syndromic surveillance, from social media, from other things, is making a pretty big investment in sort of signal-to-noise detection and science, so that when we get to the fusion space, we actually can figure out what's signal and what's noise. And this is a place where I feel like scientifically, it's part largely an engineering problem, but scientifically, we have a lot more work to do. I do think there are models of agencies working together, and we've been living those the past couple of years in doing that. I don't think that's really as much of a hang up as strengthening the capacities, the signal to noise, and everybody being on the same page about what they mean here.
Question here in the front.
Craig Venter Institute in Synthetic Genomics. As you mentioned, things are changing rapidly with flu vaccine production. We've been working with BARDA and with Novartis, and we can now make synthetically the flu seeds that in less than 24 hours, and the whole process to have a seed in less than 5 days. How are all of you going to be working with WHO and international groups? It's not a U.S. decision right now what vaccine will be made. We could potentially have vaccines ready to go even all the way through production long before the WHO would even meet to make a decision. How do we bring molecular biology and these modern techniques to WHO?
Well, Tom, CDC scientists are pretty involved in the WHO process.
Many years ago, Bill Fagey said to me, we have to work with WHO, and if we are going to work with WHO, we have to strengthen WHO. And I think that's still very much the case. If there weren't a WHO, we would have to create it. And it provides the venue for global collaboration in the detection of which viruses are likely to hit us. And flu vaccine is actually quite a good model of global collaboration, because we know what's circulating in the southern hemisphere now, and over the last few months, we have a pretty good idea of what's going to circulate here in the future. So I think we need to identify where, if there are key breakdowns in the process, we can address them and then address them. I don't think that's an insurmountable problem. I think some of the newer vaccine technologies will provide much larger challenges in issues of safety, because there is a difference between a vaccine that's given once or in a 3 or 5 dose series and a vaccine that's given every year. And the possibility of anamnestic response and of unintended negative consequences is quite substantial. And it's a lot of vaccine given every year to a lot of people. We already have a dangerous amount of vaccine hesitancy in this country. Parents who say, I'm not going to vaccinate my kid. And so we really need to err quite strongly, especially in the absence of a high virulence pathogen, of a higher virulence than seasonal flu. We need to err quite strongly on the side of safety.
We'll have one more question from the audience.
I have a two-part question. The first is,
could you identify yourself?
I'm sorry, Steve Austin with BioCentury. If DOD and HHS are indeed joined at the hip, why are you pursuing separate centers of advanced manufacturing when Congress had suggested that you consider doing them together? And the broader question is, what's your response to DA Henderson's assertion that there isn't leadership in biopreparedness now, and that until we have that, we're just milling around?
Okay, I'll answer the first question. I don't have it with me, but I'd like to quote the Standard Armed Services language in the Defense Authorization Act that actually cites the integrated efforts of HHS and DOD in developing this flexible response capability, advanced development and manufacturing capability together as a model for what Congress has been pushing us to do. Unfortunately, some people who don't understand how closely we're coordinating on this effort see it as duplicative, and it absolutely is in no way duplicative.
How is it not duplicative? Is it looking at developing different products for a different audience, or in what way is it not duplicative?
These are national priorities. One example I use, I also work on nuclear weapons. Traditionally, we've had two national laboratories working on design. We've had Los Alamos and Livermore. And the model of having that type of combined effort, but two points of view, a little bit different focus, has benefited greatly in this area. So we're going to be working on a regular basis on this integrated effort. Our needs are slightly different. The main difference is we all need FDA-approved drugs, whether it's a soldier or a civilian. The dose requirements are different for the armed forces than they are for the overall U.S. population, but it's the capabilities that we need to develop. DOD does have some specific needs that we want to focus on, current gaps that we want to fill. We tend to have at least during normal times, a somewhat higher risk tolerance for prophylaxis than the public at large, and our ability to vaccinate our force against smallpox is a good example of that.
Nikki, you get the last word here.
Let me just make a couple of other points about this. We actually sort of sat down and said, what kind of capabilities are required in an advanced development manufacturing facility for civilian use that HHS is funding, and what is in DOD? And so we sort of did the columns to look at the degree to which there was overlap and which there wasn't, and so that we could be as responsible as we can be with taxpayer resources. It's also the case that we have a tremendous amount of collaboration. We've been involved in each other's RFPs. We're involved in each other's reviews. DOD will be providing funding for the core running of the ADM facilities that we support. So at every step of the way, what you see is a lot of collaboration and communication built into the system. And that's not just the case, frankly, with these ADM facilities. It is the case with our entire portfolio, where this integrated portfolio now has really come to fruition, and we've got very full visibility and collaboration into all of the different products that we make. We sit down at least once a month in a portfolio review together and work together across this whole spectrum into all these different things. Finally, about your question about leadership, I think now that there is extremely strong leadership both in the White House and in each of the agencies involved, and I can tell you, and I think my colleagues will also reiterate, that during every single event that we've seen, during the planning of the Secretary's medical countermeasure review, during each of these things, we get together once a week, if not every day, in the Situation Room or elsewhere, work through the issues, work through the ideas, get it on the table. I think the information sharing and decision making in this regard is really quite good, quite collaborative, and quite integrated. And you get all the different points of view and can make the best possible decision that way.
We're going to need to call it there. I want to thank the panel for a really interesting, stimulating discussion. How long for break? When do you want people back? 15 minutes? So we're going to take the full 15-minute break. If you can be back in your seats by 5 to 3. Thanks.